Danis Rexpus, the monarch. We don't have many monarchs in Washington, especially the last few years. They haven't been coming in very large numbers. In fact, here in Western Washington, there are almost no monarchs. We've seen a few in the past, but now the sightings are so confused with wedding releases and special project releases that we don't know what's natural. There's no way to tell what's natural and what's been released. So on the west side, most sightings are very much suspect. On the east side of the mountains, the monarchs do migrate in pretty much up the Columbia River and the major tributaries, like up the Yakima. They have made it as far as, San Mahican, we were just talking about, you go up the Okanagan River and then branch up the San Mahican and then goes clear up to Canada. They have gotten them up as far as just over the border into Canada, but they're very rare there. This summer, Joe and I went down to southern Idaho, and we went down to the Craters of the Moon. It's a national, not park, it's a national monument. And this about where that red spot shows there on the map of Idaho. And as far as I know, monarchs didn't actually make it out to Washington this year, at least I haven't heard any reports. This area is a historic area. This is a branch of the Oregon Trail. There was a section of the main Oregon Trail that goes pretty much through Boise that became so hostile with the natives that they made this cutoff further north. It went through some real rough lava land, and that's where this Goodale's cutoff is. And right next to the cutoff, right along the road there, is this neat little lake and this nice green area. Now this is a very dry area. It's fairly high. It's 5,000 feet. But it's dry and there's very little green vegetation around. So there's a little oasis there. And we stopped for a minute and then we started seeing butterflies flying around, including monarchs. And I'll talk a little later about that. But anyway, so we looked around a little bit. Joe spotted monarchs flying down into the milkweeds. They weren't, in the past I've seen monarchs kind of land on the top of milkweeds and bend their abdomen and oviposit on the underside of the milkweed leaves. But these were disappearing down in the milkweeds. Many of the plants were getting kind of old and leathery, but some in the greener areas as you get down, kind of paw your way down to the bottom, the plants were still pretty fresh. And this was in August, was it? Or early into September already? I think they're in September already. So this is real late in the season, and the monarchs are actually landing on these milkweeds and crawling down, way down to the bottom, and they're ovipositing on these leaves on the milkweeds. Anyway, we looked around and found several eggs, and I brought a couple home and got one of them reared up. This is what the eggs look like, pretty typical of Reichsfuss. What do you call that shape?
Egg shape.
Pointy egg, okay. And it has these vertical ribs with the many little cross ribs. Very typical of Reichsfuss eggs. First instar, the monarch larvae are quite beautiful. They're banded. Even in first instar, when they first pop out of the egg, you get this brown and white or dark and white banding with a very black head. And as you get up the second instar, you get into this yellow, white, black tiger type appearance. So they kind of retain this sort of appearance all the way through growth. They're already starting to form these little horns on the two ends. This little second instar is only 8 millimeters long. And of course these caterpillars consume the milkweed. One of the ways you can identify milkweeds is you can tear a leaf or break a stem and they immediately start exuding a white material that people call latex. It's not really latex, but it looks like latex, kind of a viscous white material. And this stuff is pretty toxic. If you leave it on your skin, it'll burn your skin. And it's when the larvae feed on these leaves, the toxicity is carried over into the larvae. So they become toxic. And when you see this kind of coloration in larvae, this very bright banded kind of color, this is called a posematic coloration. This is what the biologists call it. And basically, the larva is saying, eat me if you want, but you're going to regret it. Because the beans are toxic. And
the other people call warning colors. You call it a post-somatic.
Yeah.
I said other people call it warning colors.
Right, it's the same thing, warning colors. But all the way through development, this is up to the third instar. It's 17 millimeters, it's kind of pushing an inch already. And the antennae are getting a little bit longer, but still they're retaining that same coloration. On the fourth instar, they're not really antennae, but these barbules are getting ever longer. And finally, the mature larva develops these very long processes, pretty dramatic. There's a number of relatives of the monarch, the queen, and there's several other things that when you get down into the tropics in Mexico and on down to Central America, there's a number of related species. And they all have larvae that are very much similar to this, and they all feed on milkweeds. And then the pupa, very distinctive pupa. There's no other pupa in Washington, in the Pacific Northwest, that looks anything like the monarch. It's initially green, has these rhythm metallic spots in a row, other little scattered metallic spots. And as it matures, eventually after, in this case, after about, I think 7 or 8 days, the shell of the pupa became clear. Instead of being green and opaque, it became clear, and then the wings of the developing monarch inside would show right through very clearly.
Dave, what does fairy mean?
Thank you.
I'm sorry?
What does fairy mean?
Oh, fairy, yeah. I was going to ask if anybody knew what fairy means. A fairy means something that's just about ready to molt, and it's usually applied to adult insects ready to come out of the pupa. So this is the fairy pupa, because you can see the butterflies just about ready to bust out. In fact, they don't turn this color. They don't turn clear with the butterfly showing through in this species until literally hours before the butterfly hatches. So this photo was taken probably a couple hours before the adult popped out. And again, the adult, very typical of the monarch group, they have these white spots on the black body and of course the black spots around the fringe. You can't see it too well at this angle, but dorsally, you see there's this dark spot down here on one vein, and that that is very useful for telling which sex this is. Anybody know if that means male or female?
Male.
Male.
Yeah, good. That's a male. And
does that have pheromones on it? Is that one of those spots that's a pheromone spot?
Yes, I believe it is. that attracts the females. This particular butterfly is, as we speak, is winging its way south of Mexico, I believe.
Did it take it just a month to go from egg to adult?
It took just almost exactly 30 days from the time I found the egg until the adult was. And that's a little slower, I think, than sometimes. We have reared them before where they mature a little faster than that. This is the milkweed that we found the eggs on, Asclepias fasciculatus. This is the narrow leaf milkweed. The one we have more commonly in Washington is a different species. But again, you can tell instantly if you suspect something's milkweed by just tearing a leaf or cutting a stem, and immediately that white latex exudes out.
Now, dog bane has that too, and there may be other things with the white milk, but okay. That's a good help.
Okay. Yeah, I know there are other plants. That, I think, generally speaking, anything that exudes latex, you kind of be aware of it, because there may be some toxicity there.
Don't eat it.
Yes.
Dave, where did you find your egg?
Well, they were on the leaves.
No, but I mean, where location-wise?
It was at this location down by Craters of the Moon in southern Idaho.
Okay.
Yeah, and they were in that good old cut off that place I had the photograph of. They were in the milkweeds right there. So that's where we found the eggs. So this was a native butterfly that we reared and released. It's not native right here, but it's certainly native to the Pacific Northwest. It would be nice to know where it's migrated to, but of course we'll never know. These are the seed pods, and you're probably familiar with the seed pods on our local milkweed. The milkweed, they're much fatter than these are rather slender. But the butterflies, the larvae will actually eat any part of this plant. They'll eat the flowers, they'll eat the pods, they'll eat the leaves, they'll even eat the stems. So they're consumed just about any part of the plant as long as it's fresh. This is our local showing milkweed, it's Labia speciosa. And this is the one we see over in Yakima County and Kittitas County quite a lot. This one was taken at that Hare Street location we have down at the bottom of Greaser. You can see the hair streaks on the flowers there.
Which hair streaks are?
These are the sylvan hair streaks, the light phase sylvan. A lot of butterflies nectar on milkweed. It's a great milkweed. It's a great nectar source. And that's all I have.
Question?
Yeah.
Question and statement. Question, I've heard reports that monarchs will actually eat pumpkin until maturity, but will never actually pupate federally pumpkin. Can you confirm this? Do you know anything about that?
Don't know anything about that.
Don't know anything about that, okay. Secondly, when I worked in the butterfly exhibit, just how distinctive and beautiful the monarch pupa is, we would get people asking if we painted those gold spots on the pupa. They did not believe that could be real.
Yeah. So there's a number of, as you know from the butterflies, there's a number of species that have very bright metallic spots on the pupae. Some species have the whole pupae bright gold metallic, but some of them can be pretty dramatic. Yes.
Monarchs have gotten around the world. I think they're in New Zealand or over in Europe now. If they ever got in a good spot, would they lose their urge to migrate?
Well, they are kind of all over the world. They're in Africa and Australia and Europe. And I know in Australia they migrate less, but they still migrate. I think in Central America they still migrate, but again, not as extensively as they do here. I'm sure most people know the story of the monarchs that they do overwinter as adults, mostly in Mexico and along the California coast. This last generation that I just reared is the non-productive generation. They're sexually immature. They never mature sexually. They go ahead and migrate to their wintering grounds, which again can be a couple thousand miles away. And they'll amass in big groups and overwinter as adults. And those same individuals next spring will become sexually mature and will start migrating north. And they'll mate and lay their eggs, and that'll be the first generation. And then the next generation will migrate further north, have another generation. This is probably the third generation here. And at this stage, this third stage, this is the one that migrates back to their wintering grounds. How they get back there to the very same wintering grounds, I don't think anybody's ever figured out. But they're two generations removed from the grandparents that left there. And how these descendants go back to the very same trees their grandparents were on. Grandparents were long since dead. No connection at all with them. They do it every year. Pretty amazing.
So a monarch, let's just say they're in Canada. One species will make the trip, one individual will make the trip all the way to Mexico. Mm-hmm. And then the next generation will come up maybe to northern Mexico. And
actually,
then another one will be up into Oklahoma, or
actually, that same individual over the next spring will come up to maybe northern Mexico.
And then there will be one other that will go part way up, and then the next one will go up in Canada again.
Yeah.
Sometimes they will have another brood at the farthest point north, like in Toronto.
Mm-hmm. That would be four broods.
Yeah, and they have recorded it. At times, but usually it's four generations before the fourth one goes back down, but they have recorded five.
It all depends on how long the growing season is.
Yeah.
Does any other butterfly migrate anything like that?
We have migrations, but it's usually, the painted lady, mostly the painted lady is migrating north on expansion years, and most of them never return south. They can't overwinter up here, so most of them just die, but some of them go back. And they would be probably third generation also. But they don't, I don't think they go back to a specific overwinter site. They just go generally south and might end overwinter all over, like in Mexico.
So worldwide, this is a pretty unique species.
It really is, yeah.
That's amazing.
Dave, the monarchs that overwinter in California, do they mix with the monarchs that overwinter in Mexico when they come north, or are they from distinct geographic areas?
That's what Bob Pyle wrote about with his book, Chasing Monarchs. He was trying to determine that, and he found evidence that some of the butterflies that get into the eastern part of Cascade, at least into parts of Idaho, probably cross over the Rockies and go to Mexico. But the great majority of the, probably most everything we have in Washington and Oregon is going to overwinter in California. But they don't know really. I mean, there's been some tagging efforts, but we have so few monarchs in Washington to tag that very few tags show up. There's been quite a few tags from the East Coast that have shown up in Mexico. They have a fairly good handle on that. But we have very little data there.
When I was back at Cape May, the Hog Watch, the butterflies from Toronto or farther north actually follow the same migrant path as the hawks do, the raptors. And a lot of people go back there and you see the migrating monarchs just clinging to the trees at night.
We probably have more migration here than we know. But on the East Coast, the prevailing winds, of course, come from the west to the east. So the winds drive the dragonflies and the butterflies and the birds. It drives them out to the ocean. And once they get near the salt water, they fight the wind to stay over land. So they concentrate along the coast. That's where it's real obvious that there's a migration taking place. Occasionally, we get an east wind here this time of year, and there's some people down along the Oregon coast that have been noting migrations here. Not necessarily monarchs, because there are very few monarchs, but different kinds of dragonflies and various kinds of butterflies. They are now noting that there are migrations on our coast when we get these events, driving them back toward the ocean.
Okay. Well, we're savoring this one, Dave, because this is the last one that Dave is going to do. Hereafter, the information is in the book. So what will we do with that species of the month? But anyway, thank you, Dave.